Welcome, welcome, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. This is the Reclamation Project, where we believe in no soul left behind. We are here to provide a platform for both believers and non-believers to ask the tough questions, even when they're controversial, seemingly blasphemous, or otherwise offensive. It is our mission to give answers that are rooted in science and evidence where at all possible, but most certainly objective ones that aren't based or depend on our feelings. At the end of the day, it is our hope that you'll achieve a better understanding of God, which we know improves your perception, hence also your impression of him. After all, understanding is a difference maker and a deal breaker. And well, if you're already a believer, welcome to the opportunity of perhaps relearning some things of the Bible. So we thank you and we're happy that you have joined us today. Forgiveness. This is one of the hardest things for a human to do. Like not sinning at all. And I am no exception to that. Forgiveness is just difficult. So has God really made it mandatory? Or does he simply recommend it? Surely there's a good reason for it other than just the benefits of reconciliation between two people. We hear that all the time, you know, the benefits of two people reconciling and coming together. But is there more to it than just that? So we're going to invite the panelists back, first of all, and we're going to address these questions and more. And they're poised to break it down once again in bite-sized chunks. So without further ado, let's bring the gentlemen in. Come on, Pastor Andre Campbell, Pastor Trey Hayden, who's mobile, but he's here. Come on, hey. That's what I'm talking about. And of course, Elder Terrence. My brothers, how y'all doing today?
Good, good.
Doing great, man. Glad to be here.
All right. So we're talking about forgiveness today. And so unlike the way we often proceed in format with our panel, I just want to give everybody a chance to answer all these questions. No assignments today. And so let's begin with the question. And I'm gonna have Pastor Drago address us first this time, since he often is the one who likes to bring up the rear. I want him to set the tone today. So this question of forgiveness, first let's define it first. Mm-hmm. What is forgiveness in your own words? Let's start that way.
Well, I mean, for me, and according to the word, forgiveness is a supernatural power that God gives us to be able to, on one hand, forgive the offender, the one who's offended us, to remove that offense out of our lives. Because when someone does something to us, it can create a hurdle, an obstacle that is hard for us to overcome as well, because we've been offended. So forgiveness is a tool that allows us to release that person from what they've done, but also to remove that hurdle from our lives, you know, to put in a real basic sense.
Pastor Trey, come on, would you come up next? What you got? What's forgiveness? Give it to me in your own words. Uh-oh, can you hear? Can you guys hear me?
Hey, can you hear me?
Okay, we can hear you. Mm-hmm. Did you get the question? You're up. What's forgiveness in your own words?
Well, you talking about the panel's gonna break it down. We're gonna get broken down. Because this forgiveness is no joke. Forgiveness to me is totally emptying one of self. It is not living in your feelings, but living in faith and trying to treat others the way you want God to treat you. Because where would we be if it was not for the forgiveness of God?
Got it. Got it. Come on, Elder.
Forgiveness. I guess forgiveness for me, and I concur with everything that's been said thus far, but I would say that forgiveness actually is it's a personal responsibility. As Pastor Campbell alluded to, forgiveness can often be a hurdle, an object, you know, set before us to beset us. It's our responsibility to do all that we can to overcome that obstacle, to overcome that hurdle. And so the first way, actually the best way, the only way, truthfully, to overcome that hurdle is to go ahead and forgive. I could elaborate more, but I'll save that for a little later on during this talk.
Well, I tell you this much. We got time today. Miss Yolande is away today. Okay. We get to gobble up Bible trivia. So I'll go ahead and just give a crack at it. One of the things that I will say about forgiveness is that it's not inherent. We are not born with it. It is a learned behavior. In fact, it might be one of the most challenging learned behaviors that we have, because let forgiveness be challenged. Let forgiveness be challenged in your life, and let's see how well you come out with being an example of forgiveness. So it's definitely a learned behavior. It's not inherent. We weren't, I don't believe anybody was born with it. We didn't come out forgiven, being able to forgive others. So yeah, that's my take. So right. Now let's any other comments, actually, any other,
I was going to kind of dig into Matthew 18, which is one of those stories where we see we see an example of forgiveness, where there was a king who forgave, or you know, a ruler who forgave a man a debt that he owed to him, but then he went out after being forgiven and he didn't extend that same forgiveness to others. Instead, he was like horrible in the way that he treated those that were indebted to him. So, you know, forgiveness is something that when we receive it, we freely receive it, we freely should also give it. But I think a lot of times people, you know, sometimes all we have is that anger. You know, so much has been taken from us from the offense. You know, let's imagine somebody being abused or mistreated in life, or just taken advantage of all the time. And you almost feel like that's all you have. So you're holding on to that anger and that hurt, and you don't want to release that. You know, it's such a topic that, man, we could really go so down so many pathways, because it affects people in right. So many different ways. But that story, you know, reminds us that just as God has forgiven us, you know, we should also forgive others, you know.
Okay. All right. I like that. So
statistics prove,
come on,
that those that do not forgive, they have more health as well as mental challenges in their life. And in the end, they end up affecting themselves in a negative way if they hold bitterness and resentment in their heart.
Mm-hmm. Come on. I like that. Pastor Trey already is getting ahead. He ain't taking off. He's already talking about the impact of not participating in it. Mm-hmm. But if we can just stay here just a little bit longer with what it is, what it's defined by. I like that what you said, Pastor Trey. Let me ask this. Is it mandatory? Is it something that we have to do? So let me give you an example. Let me play devil's advocate. When a certain man asked another certain man or apostle, what must I do to be saved? There was an answer that was given, but the answer was not that you needed to forgive. So I know I'm starting something a little bit by putting it this way, But the point I want to make is to I want you guys to articulate, is it something that we should be doing, that God wants us to be doing? Is it just a recommendation, or is it something that's mandatory? Do we get?
No, it's mandatory.
Yeah. I might toss a little different twist on it, even though I feel that it is necessary, it is expected of us. But then there's reasoning behind it. So the first thing I said was that it's a supernatural power, right? Forgiveness. So the Hebrews looked at forgiveness like a coin. I don't know if we ever talked about this on TRP, but they looked at forgiveness like a coin. On one side of the coin, you have forgiveness. On the other side, you have forgetting, right? And so if you don't take a hold of this supernatural power, as Trey said, having an unforgiving heart could lead to sickness. It could lead to depression. It could lead to so many different things. But God has given us this power that the world doesn't have. The world says they forgive you, but then there's always revenge cooking in the back of people's minds. So God has given us this supernatural power that when we forgive, and again, forgiveness is for the offender, forgetting is for the offended. And if we only say that we forgave the person that offended us, but we don't turn on the other side of that power, which is for us, for our benefit, then we might be stifled and stymied in life, as well as get sick behind this, because we really truly haven't taken. So do we? Is it mandatory? I think that it is. It would be foolish not to forgive. And Christians, knowing this, recognizing that this is a power, we want to take hold of it.
I like
so,
that.
So I'm looking here in my notes at in terms of forgiveness in Matthew 6:14-15. The word says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, excuse me, their reckless and willful sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, nurturing your hurt and anger with the result that it interferes with your relationship with God, then your Father will not forgive you your trespasses. Now, for me, that segues into 1 John 4:20. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For the one who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. That also segues, and I'm finished with this, 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, freedom, emancipation from bondage, and true freedom. And so that's what forgiveness does. Forgiveness frees us from that heavy weight, that burden that we carry around from intentionally either hating this person or just having some ill will in our heart, some malice in our heart toward this person. And you know that this is true because when the person enters the room, your entire personality changes. You shift, you transform, and you've given them that power. And so you have to resume that power by forgiving them. And therefore, you're a perfect example of that Spirit of the Lord dwelling within you. And so that's really my take on this whole forgiveness thing in a nutshell.
I like that. If I might pick it up before Pastor Trey go, I see that you look a little frozen, just by the way, so hopefully you're still there. But let me set you up if I may. So I like that. So this forgiveness thing, you know, it seems to be this attribute that, well, first of all, let me answer that question direct. I believe also that it's mandatory. And everything that you guys have just said up to this point, it appears as though God made it mandatory, but he did so indirectly. He didn't actually say directly that this is what you need to do in order to make it into heaven or to come and hang out with me. But in so many words, indirectly, there's like a little formula. There's a connection. If you don't embody forgiveness, you're going to miss out. And I absolutely love the idea of that God sometimes doesn't explicitly state all of these things that he needs us to embody, all these virtues he needs us to have. but rather he likes to point out, he likes to show you how certain attributes are toxic and they spoil our character. And a spoiled character is just not fit to hang out with him because he needs people around him. Now, this is a must. Everybody who's around him need to have a refined character. You guys need to, you need to have some things right with the way that you think. And so forgiveness impacts, embodying forgiveness impacts the way we think as well as doing what Pastor Dre talked about, how, you know, you've got the two sides of the coin. I absolutely love that. Embodying forgiveness precipitates change in us, in our characters, and it makes us harmonious. It makes us fit. It makes us right to hang out with the creator of the universe. Come on.
You know, Stan, even science says somewhat the same thing. So again, I'm looking here at my notes, and I did a little light research, and it says here that psychologists generally define forgiveness as a conscious, deliberate decision to release feelings of resentment or vengeance toward a person or a group who has harmed you, regardless of whether they actually deserve your forgiveness. Forgiveness does not mean forgetting, nor does it mean condoning or excusing offenses. And they go on to say, forgiveness is for our own growth and happiness. When we hold on to hurt, pain, resentment, and anger, it harms us far more than it harms the offender. Forgiveness frees us to live in the present. Our anger, regret, hatred, or resentment towards someone means that we are giving up our power to that person. Wow. This is what science says.
Come on, I love it. Come on, Dre, you have
I mean, when you know, so as you were sharing, I was thinking about like the monkey who puts his hand, who gets trapped. They set up the monkey trap and he puts his hand in there and he grabs a hold of some nuts and he wants to bring his arm out, but it's stuck because his fist can't come back out. And he, for the life of him, to save his life, will not let go of those nuts. And and so I think of like unforgiveness like that. Like God is saying, look, you will destroy yourself. This is not about God destroying us because we choose not to forgive. This is like, you know, I've given you this freely, but because of your unforgiveness, you are allowing the works of the flesh to destroy you. And Terrence was pointing that out with those scriptures, that it's really something that we end up doing to ourselves, and to the scientific explanation as well. We're doing that to ourselves. And God is like, I'm trying to show you the way. And the way is forgiveness. If you don't forgive, if you hold that in your heart, there's nothing I can do for you. I can't do nothing for you. I've given you salvation through Christ, but you're actually destroying yourself by virtue of being unforgiven. You're harboring that. You're holding on to that.
Come on, Trey. Hey, Trey, you better jump in here, man. If you back on.
We got to get Trey a connection booster, man. He's
Well, are you ready? Otherwise, go ahead, Trey. While you get your connection right.
I'm almost, I got everything set up here. Hold on. Okay.
He done pulled out the Bible, man. I see him looking in the Bible.
All right. Why you get those scriptures? Why you get those scriptures together? Man, I love that monkey analogy. That story. I thought it was cookies, but it was nuts. Whatever it was, wanted it.
Bananas.
he wanted it all the same. But that is just so powerful. Are you kidding me? Some things that we want to hang on to for so long. But by giving them up, there is something better in store. In this case, extended life. And I just love the way you put it, that by hanging on to those things that are of lesser value than your life, we bring about destruction. And in the case with, let's see, shall I say it this way? In the case with hanging out with God, I mean, it's destruction literally eventually is what it becomes. But let me just soften it a little bit and just say that you miss out on an opportunity to hang out with an individual, a person, and a personality who is the creator of all living things. Oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. What's so worth
it? Looks like Trey got a good connection now, man.
Come on, Trey. You better
come on, Trey. Can you hear us?
I definitely agree with you guys. I believe it's mandatory. I believe it is mandatory. And the reason why is because Jesus, like he said in his prayer, forgive us our sins as we forgive our debtors. So if we have unforgiven sins, we're not going to make it. That's why it's mandatory to forgive others.
I like that. And when he said that, it made me think about this show that I was watching with my son, and the man was really scolding the other individual, calling them an angry Christian. And so in essence, when you're not willing to forgive as a Christian, that's what you are, an angry Christian. And to me, that's just an oxymoron. It doesn't really make sense. You know, I understand that we will all go through trials. You know, this life is not a peachy creamy one. I was just talking to my wife about that, how, you know, once we even open our mouths and make ourselves make the declaration that, you know, we want to be baptized, we've therefore waged war on the enemy. So get that part.
That's right.
But the whole point is we're in the middle of a pandemic, right? If you're truly a Christian, you're not running around here scared like a chicken with your head cut off, right? You understand that based on scriptures themselves, that things like this were going to transpire. And so, you know, it hasn't shifted your faith away from God. If anything, it should have pushed you closer to him, right? And so being angry just is just, to be unforgiving as a whole is just not consistent with the character of God. And that's the best way that I can put it. When I think about that, what comes to mind is the thief on the cross. And actually there were two, but only one of them had the sense of mind to really repent for his sins and ask for forgiveness right then and there. And so I say that if that weren't important, then that wouldn't even be in the body of the Bible itself. So, yeah, I wanted to point out one thing about science. They gave us a few critical steps as to how to help a person from keep getting hurt or, you know, continuing to be hurt. But the one that stuck out the most to me, and the first one was to move away from the past. The second was to reconnect with yourself. The third was avoid going to sleep angry. And then the next was to stop blaming others, avoid trying to control people, learn the art of letting go. But the one that really hit me the hardest was number 7. It says here, aim to be kind instead of being right.
Wow. Right?
And so often when it comes to unforgiveness, when it comes to even arguments altogether, many of us will, and I'm included, I have to include myself in this actually, unfortunately, but many times you get so caught up in this verbal assault that it shifts from you trying to get the other individual to understand how you feel to you simply just trying to be right. And there's a difference in the two. And then lastly was to embrace those dark times that will come, you know, as you travel that road, that journey to restoration, to, you know, becoming a better person, healthier emotionally and spiritually and so forth. And so, you know, the fact that there's this myriad of prescriptions to help us to get better, to restore ourselves in the act of forgiveness tells me that this is a serious issue. And so the world can see it. Definitely the Bible talks about it on more than one occasion. And so, again, I just have to reiterate, yes, this is totally mandatory.
Come on.
Pastor.
So let me show a couple of pictures. I want to show a series of pictures, and I want everybody just kind of just give your thoughts on it. Because what you just said, Terrence, is a good segue Mm-hmm. Forgiveness. I mean, is there any other term, any other attribute in the Bible that we deal with more or perhaps poses more challenges for us in this life than forgiveness? And while others, while many may think, well, that would actually be quite naive, but there's still some might think that forgiveness is a challenge that can be relegated to small children. We know that that's further from the case, but I just want to just give me your thoughts, brother and sister.
Actually, that's where forgiveness begins.
In the home. Anybody else? Bringing back memories?
Oh, you mean this picture right here?
Uh-huh.
Well, you know, I mean, I actually was just processing the story of Joseph and his brothers. I can come back to that in a little bit. You know, in that regard.
All right. Hey, let's try this one. That's not getting you. So again, we talked about how it's not disregard the top left logo and all that entails. But come on, first thoughts. We're going back to English and comprehension now, just a little bit. tell me what you see.
I mean, I see like a wedge placed between them, even though it's invisible, you know, the body language and everything. It's like, you know, there's a wall of separation created.
Mm-hmm. It strikes me as a caste system. I remember one of the young people from the church out here was telling me that he went to an area high school, which I won't name, but it's a very affluent one. And when he got there, one of his fellow students asked him what his parents did for a living. And so when he revealed what they did, the student responded with, "Oh, you're old, you're new money. I'm old money. So therefore we can't be friends." Right. Hmm. And so that's what I see. I mean, we all see what we see, but that's what I see here. A caste system. One person feels like they're this and they're above the other one. And the other one to me actually looks like she doesn't really care. Like, you know, do your thing. I'm going to be me. So yeah, that's what I get.
Let me try this. Let me add this in here. Assuming that both of these sets of pictures are sibling, when they're children and you got a problem with a sibling and you're dealing with forgiveness, it's very out in the open. You know, nobody's putting on airs. It's very clear. Mm-hmm. It's very clear how you feel. But somehow there's a transition when we become adults and we've arrived. We've mm-hmm. arrived. It begins to look a little more like this. Why is that? Well, come on, talk to me.
Stan, I would dare to suggest that that's probably because as we age, particularly in those teenage years, what the outside world says about us seems to mean more to us at that time. And so, you know, you're talking about those teenage years in particular versus being a little kid. Little kids are impressionable as well, but you know, those teenage years, you do tend to see a little separation. I notice even separation between myself and my siblings being the youngest. You know, folks, they begin to, I don't know, start walking into what they believe is their truth.
So we got people who will teach the, you know, we've got many people who will say, you know, well, there's a conflict between young kids here. Let me help you out. You know, everybody loves to be a teacher and want to be the person who's showing people the way. And for little kids, you know, I can just see them saying, you know, hey, you know, violence, resorting to violence and, you mm-hmm. know, walking around moping with an attitude, that's not the way we do it. So you need to change those things about you. The problem is that when we get older, so so what that we get rid of the, you know, the very quick violent nature, you know, just want to hit. That's how kids deal with their anger or things that they're not getting. Walking around with a very evident attitude on your face. So we get rid of those things. We grow out of those as we get older. But what do we do when we get older? We get more sophisticated with our thing. Now we start being what we call it, fake and phony. But we're still,
this is true,
we're still dealing with, we're still talking about the same issue, forgiveness. So what say you?
Right.
Wait.
You know, and that's the way, so it can be in church as well. But Jesus admonished the early Christian church that they were supposed to pray for one another. They were supposed to forgive one another and also encourage and admonish each other. If those things aren't being done, the devil will put a wedge in between any relationship.
And let me piggyback off that a little bit. As we always say, let's piggyback off of it. You know, I go back to Cain and Abel. I can fast forward to Joseph, story of Joseph and his brothers. Mm-hmm. I mean, what we see is that there's a downward spiral that takes place when we choose not to forgive. And again, back to the fruit of the spirit versus the works of the flesh. And so Jesus admonished us. He said, don't let your anger turn into wrath, right? But what are we angry about? Are we angry about the fact that somebody did us wrong? I mean, right now, if you cut somebody off on the highway, I know that most people here in Florida, when you drive by the gun range, it's not just pickup trucks and low riders in the gun range. It's convertible BMWs, and you know what I'm saying? Everybody's got a gun. And right now, when people get angry, they're escalating. Like the news headlines are, you know, there was a disagreement in the parking lot and nobody wants to forgive. Nobody wants to say, nah, it's okay, man. You know, it's all right. They're pulling out guns. 10 people just got shot today or last night in Missouri, right? Outside of some club or some mall or something like that over a disagreement. 2 people are dead and 8 people are injured. And I guarantee you there's hundreds of those headlines over the last couple of weeks because people have just chosen to be unforgiving. And so what did Cain do when he perceived an offense from his brother Abel, when it really wasn't an offense? His brother did what God asked and he didn't do what God asked, but he got upset and he killed his brother. And God came to him, I think on TRP one time or somewhere I preached on you know, at the threshold. I was talking about Jesus being at the door, knocking on the door. And I used the example of the reason a lot of times we don't want to open the doors because life is, you know, what we find on the other side of the door isn't that wonderful. It's sin is on the other side of the door. Anger is on the other side of the door. Unforgiveness is on the other side of the door. And God came to Cain and said, hey, what's going on? And apparently Cain obviously was trying to play it off. And God said, if you do well, you know, it's going to be all right. But if you sin, but if you don't, sin is waiting at the door for you. Mm-hmm. I think being unforgiving is the 800-pound gorilla. And if you're in a cage, if you're in a cage, Trey, with an 800-pound gorilla, who's in charge?
No, sir. Not me.
No, I'm glad that Andre brought that up. You know, because in America, we have 37, we have, what was the statistic? 37,000 gun violence deaths per year. That's about 100 per day. But the thing is that most of those deaths from gun violence is self-inflicted. And I'm not even sure if we even started talking about forgiving yourself.
I was getting to that.
Man, you set me up too. I'm gonna let you go, Terrence, but you set me up, Dre, with talking about, you know, the violence and people wanting to take vengeance with this next slide right here. So as we look at this, go ahead, Terrence, say what you're saying and let's read into this.
Well, you know, this what I'm about to say next, I think I'm sure I've discussed it with the three of you before, but it's still relevant to the topic at hand. we can start with how just amazingly how amazing it was to see a young man. If you remember, his brother was the one that was killed in Texas by the officer who entered the wrong apartment. And I don't know if it was her arraignment or if it was her trial, but he asked the judge for permission to get up and to go and give her a hug. And he gave her a hug and he forgave her. There's another instance where a father whose son was murdered. This was an orchestrated hit. Young man was being jumped into a gang and this was his initiation. And so he killed this young man, but he was caught. And after being caught and he's going through the justice system, and you know, what was on the table was the death penalty based on the state he was in and the way in which, you know, the hit was carried out. And the father strongly protested against this. He said, taking this boy's life will not bring mine back. And he was praying with that boy and went out. They showed footage of and I'm sure you can pull this up, of the father and his wife praying with this young man's family. That's forgiveness. Mm-hmm. And so why I say that it's near and dear to my heart is because, as I've discussed on here on this platform before, you know, wow, it's 2021. 11 years ago, my oldest brother was killed. He was taken from us. And if I'm being honest with myself, anger had set into my heart. But then there was a struggle between my flesh and the Holy Spirit. And so God is telling me, look, what you're telling me is that right now you love to hate him more than you love to love me. And so I had to make a decision right then. Right? You don't understand, unless you've walked that walk, you don't understand the level of freedom that is granted to you when you forgive. Yeah. On that level, like, it's one thing somebody's, you know, one of your so-called friends came and they stole a watch or something. You're like, you know what? You know, you fell out, but you'd have made up. But when you walk by that casket, and it's certain that that person in this life is not coming back, that takes on a totally different meaning, right? So forgiveness for me was, whew. I think as I continue to revisit that in my mind, that was a defining moment in my walk with Christ. And so when you pose the question, is it mandatory? I have to say yes. Adamantly, I have to say yes. And so I pass the baton.
Can I just jump in there and say this real quick also, is that you look at the fact that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. And so when it comes to God the Father loving us,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? We are the ones that caused his own son to die. We did that to him, and he still loves us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, it takes us back to the beginning of the conversation, Stan. And Terrence, your story brings us back to the beginning when we see it brings new meaning and deeper meaning to the word mandatory. If we don't do that, what is it going to do to us? It's going to destroy us. Mm. So it is mandatory that we take hold of it, because if we don't, it is our own destruction. It'll lead us to our own destruction. We'll want to take it. So I use the example, and my wife always gives me permission. I've preached so many sermons where I tell this story. And, you know, my father-in-law, who's deceased now, you know, he wasn't really there for my wife. Like her mother would dress her up, put the pigtails in with the bows. Y'all know where I'm going with this story, right? She put on, and this old school crinoline. That's the older folk listening would know that that's the undergarment to the white dress that they put on with the patent leather shoes. And she'd sit at the table waiting for her father to come pick her up. Her mother would go, her grandmother would be there. Her mother would come back from work and her father still hadn't come, and he wouldn't come. And so there was, and that happened time and time and time again. And that really built up a type of anger in her that she didn't really know the effect of it until we got married. And, you know, wow. He and I kidnapped him and brought him to the wedding. Cause she was like, he can come to the wedding if you can get him there, right? So I kidnapped him for real, like 3 days in a hotel, giving him room service. Went and cut his hair, got him a tuxedo, and when that door opened up, wow. Nobody would have known that they didn't have a relationship.
Oh man!
So they walked down. They walked down the aisle together, and for the couple of months after the wedding, I'd be on the phone. What's up, Pops? Cause we formed a good relationship. He's a cool dude. He's an OG, and so one night. In our little apartment in Norfolk, Virginia, I came home around 9 o'clock at night and there was a letter on the bed and it started out, Andre, I hate you because he loves you.
Wow.
I hate you because he loves you. And she went on to tell the story in the letter of all those times that he let her down, he wasn't there for her, et cetera. Long story short, now that has bled over into our relationship. She couldn't finish. My wife hadn't finished anything she started in school. She had gone to mortuary science school. She'd gone to nursing school. She dropped out of all of them. Why? Because there was something processing in the back, that obstacle in her path. You know what I'm saying? And like you were saying, Terrence, if you had taken matters into your own hand and killed the dude that killed your brother, you might have to kill his whole family, really, because it could end up, of course, being a back and forth. But the release that you got by giving it to God. I mean, that was powerful as you explained that, like that release, man can't give that to us. And so my wife eventually, you know, she went, you know, I pushed her, I admonished her. And, you know, I was like, you know, and the Lord answered my prayers. And eventually she went from calling him by his first name, Alan, to calling him Dad again. Like, wow. And when he died, out of his 14 children, you know what I'm saying? You know, out of his 14 children, she was the only one that was at peace.
Mm.
Wow. She was the only one that was at peace because she had actually gotten to that point of forgiving him for not being there for her. And there's a lot more to the story, but in essence, you know, it unforgiveness creates a blockade. It puts a mountain in front of us. But that mountain has to be removed. The enemy wants that mountain to remain.
Yeah. Yeah. And see, to your point, let me just piggyback, Pastor Dre. If we don't subscribe to forgiveness, what ends up happening is our very moral compass becomes compromised and unbalanced. You alluded to the fact that, you know, I forgave this individual and whatnot, what have you, and what could have happened had I chosen to go another route. And it's funny how you said that without really knowing me at that time, had the power to do so. That's the scary part. Had the power to do so. Here's the thing. I'm at my brother's repast. Cause see, the enemy, he doesn't quit. He has no quit in him. If that didn't work, he's going to come again from another angle. So I'm at the repast for the same brother. I have one brother left. I'm at the repast, and some brothers from my neighborhood come to show their respects. And I happened to be standing outside. The repast was held at my aunt's house. I happened to be standing outside. It's myself and, you know, obviously family, my other brother, whatnot, what have you. When these brothers pull up, one of them gets out the car. And what he says to me is, we know where this brother is. Because, you know, he was in jail at that time. But they were talking about doing something to him while he's in prison. And he said to me, all I need from you is for you to green light it. I said, man, I can't do that. If I do that, then I'm not what I say I am. Watch God.
Right.
This brother begins to profusely, and I mean, man, I've never seen him act like this before. He was crying, but it was with an excitement. And he says, man, I want what you have. Mm-hmm. He said, because I know you. He said, I know you. He said, the old you would have driven the car to take care of this. I want when, and so his brothers had to grab him and restrain him. They had to put him in the car. They're pulling off, and he's still yelling out the window, I want what you have.
Wow.
Right? So I had an opportunity to show him, you know, I had forgiven his brother. Like, I have to move past this situation, and I'm praying that by God, in that example, he saw that he should too. We've since had a conversation about that ordeal. I won't get into that right now, but yeah, he's moved forward with his life. Praise God.
Can I throw something else in there? I don't want to. You know, maybe somebody's listening to this discussion today, and you know, and that you know they've been harboring anger in their heart over something that somebody has done to them, and that person may have thwarted them. They can't have a good relationship. They can't complete nothing in their life. They, you know, they're stumped. They're stifled. And, you know, I take it back to that story of Joseph. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Joseph had two sons. God prepared him for when his brothers were going to be in front of him begging for food, basically. Yes. And, you know, when his brothers came, he could have killed them. He had soldiers. He was second in command of all of Egypt. He could have been like, yo, just straight kill them all. You know, but that's not what he chose. In that moment, when he thought about them putting him in a pit, when they thought about them ridiculing him, when he thought about them selling him to his second cousin, the Ishmaelites, you know what I'm saying? Shame and scandal in the family, and him being having to basically walk behind the camels to Egypt. When you think about all of that, he had plenty reason to off all of them at that time, but he chose to forgive them. And when you look at the names of his sons, he had two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Mm-hmm. Manasseh meant to forget the toils of your father's house. Because a lot of times we're hurt by those that are closest to us in a lot of sense, right? Matter of fact, you know, black on black crime, I mean, you know, enough said, right? But his second son's name was Ephraim, which is translated as to be doubly blessed in the land of your affliction. Maybe there's somebody here today that you're finding that you're not blessed in the land of your affliction. I want to admonish you that first and foremost, you got to learn how to forgive. You got to learn how to let that offense be removed out of your life and take a hold of Terrence. I mean, you almost made me get an ugly cry on here today, bro. You know, it's like what you said is that you have supernatural power. Supernatural power, bro. And that brother was like, I want that. So maybe somebody here that's listening is saying, I'm not finding that blessing in my life. I'm living in the land of my affliction. We need to look in our hearts and seek that and seek to forgive those who have wronged us so that we can move forward. God wants to move us forward.
So, you know, that's going to be our final, that's my final question for us today before we get ready to transition. But before we, that being, what are some steps, what are some things that you can share with others who are perhaps being challenged by this virtue of forgiveness? But before we, so think about that, but before we do, you know, you know, this was both funny and I could do is shake my head. I saw this on the internet, and I thought that this was just apropos for what we're discussing, at how challenging it seems to be for so many to embody this virtue that we call forgiveness. Now, this seems a bit on the rudimentary side. I mean, are you kidding me? What was it? What was it that would compel someone for this long? What's missing in someone's life that it has to go this far? Perhaps I'm missing something. But an even more appropriate question is, how many people do we know that's like this?
Honestly, I've seen it at church.
Man.
And you will notice, I've watched people who have been at the church probably longer than I've been alive, and they will not walk on the opposite side of the church because the person that they're warring with sits on that side. So one person takes one side of the sanctuary and the other person takes the other side of the sanctuary, and they don't cross paths and they don't see anything wrong with it.
That's the Hatfields and the McCoys, man.
So as we consider this last question, we're going to go around the circle. Let's look at this one, because what you just said, Tim, isn't it? I mean, what a shame it is that for some of us, our most of our experience with unforgiveness takes place in the place where they're supposed to know. Mm-hmm. I know somebody might have a rebuttal, say, Stan, well, you know, the church is the hospital. I know. Still, though, it just seems that this ought to be that place where something like forgiveness is at least attempted. But doesn't this embody, I mean, how that?
It, for me, it speaks to how blinding unforgiveness can be. Because, for me, I can only say for myself personally, I feel like once I subscribe to employing forgiveness, this, as Pastor Jay so eloquently put it, this supernatural power of unforgiveness that was not innately in me. Trust me, it was something that I had to learn. Something I had to actually desire and again subscribe to. But once I learned that, it seemed to me like the grass was a little greener, the sun shined a little brighter. There was a pep in my step and some joy in my heart that just quite simply was not there before. Now, if those things are not appealing to you, I don't have a rap for you. I don't know what to say, but for me, I'd rather have peace more than money, more than anything. I'd rather have peace. And so that's what forgiveness has established for me and allowed me to have that peace that does surpass all understanding. And so that's my final word.
Come on, who's next? Final thought. Oh, Pastor Brady, it's just you.
Man, I'm with Terrence on that. God's forgiveness of me has meant so much to me, because I'm like, you know, I've made so many mistakes in my life, and for Him to forgive me, I want to pass that on to somebody. I want other people to experience that, and if I could be the purveyor of that, you know, the curator of that. Yes. I'm glad to be able to do that. You know, I've been wronged. I'll briefly conducted the funeral of a friend of mine who cost me $30,000 in a lawsuit. I got sued and lost because of something they did. And I was seen as the agent. I was seen as the person who connected the deal. And when he died, the family called me and asked me to do the eulogy. And I mean, woo! But Terrence, you nailed it in your final words. The liberty that it, the what it gave me to be able to stand there and speak of him at the funeral and not speak ill of him. Mm-hmm. You know, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. God got all that handled. And I pray that you know, he made his peace with the Lord. I believe he did. But I got an opportunity to just give hope to his family of a soon coming savior. And while I'm still paying that $30,000, but it was cathartic to be able to have that opportunity to do it and be willing to do it. So forgiveness is powerful. That's all I'm going to say. it will release you.
Wow. You know, Terrence really should be the one giving the last final thought on this. Here, let me let Pastor Trey go since he's back. Let's see if we can keep him connected, and then I'll just give my final quick thought on this. No, let me go ahead and just share it now. So about my question, which was to someone who is being challenged by forgiveness and wants to know what it is that we can do, what it is that they can do to help facilitate forgiveness. For me, so my answer to that question is my experience. my experience has been this, that when I am challenged with forgiving someone for some wrong that was done to me, what I have found helpful is to think about what God did for me. When I think about everything that I've done against God in my life, and the list is so long that that there is no amount of time that we'd have to discuss all of them. And I think about how God said that not only does he forgive me, but that when he returns, that he will forget that it ever happened, that there will be no record of it. Record will be expunged. Record will be destroyed. There will be no further mention for all of eternity of the things that I did. When I think about the fact that I have access to me, that privilege, and all I have to do in return is forgive someone who's done something to me that in summation is far less than what I did to God. And then I get to thinking about the fact that Jesus came down here, the one who created us came down here, put aside his godship, became a human. The creator became the creation, and he decided to live a life and endure criticism and torture and pain and ultimately death so that I could live. Oh my goodness. And all I got to do is forgive someone for that, for the things that they've done against me. One weighed against the other. It's a no-brainer. Now, it's still easier said than done. But when I allow myself to get into the mode of thinking, I force myself to ponder, what's at stake? I have to always conclude, I had better give it up. I gotta give it up. So that's what I do. I mean, that's, you know, I know everyone's got their go-to tips and tricks, but hopefully what I've just shared will be helpful with someone else. Pastor Trey, you're going to have the final word. Forgiveness.
Yeah, guys, you know, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 says, "Now we're so compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us." Everything's not a sin that's going to beset us or weigh us down. Some things are just weights, but they become too heavy. And then it says, "Run with patience the race that is set before us." And so lack of forgiveness is the heaviest weight you can ever carry. But God said, you have to lay it down. You have to let it go and give it to God. Every time you pray, you're giving your feelings, you're giving your emotions, you're giving your good and your bad, you're giving it all to God. If you're not going to let go, prayer is not going to work. And that weight is going to weigh you down and you won't make it. But if you give it to God, he'll give you strength to do all things through Christ that strengthens you.
Amen.
Amen, amen. Love it, love it. So, man, gentlemen, once again, it's always good. Always good to just hear my brothers rightly divide the word and share and exchange. I'm always learning something coming out of it. So appreciate you guys once again for being here today. So we're out of time. We're getting ready to transition into our worship service. And if you're a non-believer, we just, if you would dare, we invite you to stay by and hang on a little bit longer with us. We believe that you'll be inspired by the things that you hear by way of a talk of a special guest. We've got some good music that's coming. Got an inspiring or thought-provoking story coming up, short video. And so we just thank you for tuning in. And if not, we look forward to seeing you next week when we will have a thought-provoking subject that will be fruitful and enriching. So stand by for a few announcements.
What the world needs. Welcome, everyone. We're so glad you joined us. This is the Reclamation Project, where we believe in no soul left behind. So we're not merely taking people to Jesus. We are talking Jesus to people. And this is also where we operate with urgency, because for whatever we do for God. And it must be done now. But that said, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the speaker for today. And few are blessed with such a diverse range of talents, especially all at once. She is a lawyer, a businesswoman, add to that a gospel music composer and musician, and see, you get to see the picture that this person's talented. But more importantly, what she really holds dear or close to her heart amongst all of these many gifts is that of being a mom and an evangelist, bringing people to Jesus. So it is my pleasure to introduce the speaker of the day by way of Zimbabwe, my friend, Advocate Nyaradzo Maphosa. But first, we're going to hear special music from my brother, Lloyd Shand. And then after that, we'll hear from Advocate Nyaradzo Maphosa. But first, this message.
Let justice roll on like a river. Let righteousness be like a mighty stream. May the dividing wall of injustice fall, so we may all sit together at a common table. May the all-powerful word of God that never returns void accomplish his will of peace and equality, so we may all sit together at a common table. May each one of us practice humility and remember God created all people the same. May we turn away from discord and hate, so we may all sit together at a common table. May we stand hard against injustice, sow seeds of trust, service, and hope, and above all, love God and our neighbor, so we may all sit together at a common table. Lord, may every valley be exalted, and every hill and mountain be made low. May the uneven be made straight, the rough places made smooth, so we may all sit together at a common table. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we come here today longing for a word from you. Father, I ask that you will speak through and to Advocate Maphosa, Lord. Father, we know that there's someone watching today that needs to hear that you love them. Someone listening to today that needs to hear that you have truly made a way for them and that you want to be with them for all of eternity. And so, Father, we ask that you will lift the downtrodden today through the words that are spoken, that you will, those who are listening to this ministry today, Lord, that their lives will be touched and they will never be the same again. We thank you for forgiveness. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you for your love. And we just simply ask, Lord, forgive us for our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Lord, we look forward to living with you for all of eternity. This is our prayer today. Looking forward to a word from on high. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yes. Praise.
source of my strength, and you are the strength of my life. I lift my hands in total praise to you. Amen.
For me to be here with you. My name is Advocate Nyaradzo Maphosa, and I hail from the bright and sunny country of Zimbabwe in Africa. Now, I was very excited when I was invited to be part of the presentations that are given to you every so often, and I hope that this will not be the last of what I hope to be a series to come. Now, I thought that we would introduce each other with me just talking about a simple thing or something that might seem simple, which is the mind. And so I've called this presentation, Think, a Sermon on the Mind. Now, let us start by looking at this creature that is called the mind. I find it to be one of the most fascinating things that God created on a human being. And I need to give you a disclaimer. I am not speaking as a medical scientist or a medical practitioner of any sort, but I speak from the revelation that I have had and the fascination that I have had from just watching people and also seeing how my own mind works. Now, I always ask people when I'm making this presentation, what is the major difference between human beings and animals? And ultimately, the answer that comes out is that it is the mind. So what is it about the mind that so distinguishes human beings from all other creatures which were created by the Almighty? We notice that the mind receives and stores information. So the mind receives information through our five senses. So it is how you feel or the touch. It is what you hear that feeds your mind. It is what you eat that feeds your mind. It is what you see that feeds your mind. It is what you taste that feeds your mind. So you'll notice that, and it is what you smell, of course, that feeds your mind. And so you'll notice that the five senses are used. They are the primary sources of information that feed your mind. And so what is contained in your mind almost entirely depends on what you allow your five senses to access, or how you allow your five senses to access your mind. What else does the mind do? We notice that the mind is what we use to unravel maybe theorems, maybe to unravel equations, to understand deep science and philosophies. We use the mind. And so the mind needs to be trained every so often to capture the correct information and to store it. What else does the mind do? The mind receives signals and information and inspiration from on high. And that is the most amazing thing, because God uses our minds to communicate with us. He does not necessarily use any other part of the body. Of course, he can communicate through any other part of the body, but the primary source of communication that God uses is your mind. That is how important the mind is. I always wonder, when God wants to communicate something to you, what does he find crowding your mind? What are you allowing access into your mind which might not be in sync with what God would like to download or upload in your mind from heaven, which you will eventually download? So I find it interesting that the mind, of course, for me, the mind is a combination of the heart and the brain, all right? And what I have found to be interesting about the mind is the whole division between the subconscious mind and the conscious mind. The conscious mind being what we are aware of, right? Which actually speaks to how or informs how we behave. So when we know that we're going to a wedding, we are going to dress appropriately for a wedding. And that is the conscious mind. When you're speaking to a young child, you'll notice that you start to use appropriate language. You're not going to use deep philosophies, which the child cannot understand. That is your conscious mind. But what about this creature called the subconscious mind? To me, it is something that I continue to try and discover, continue to try and unravel. And I think most scientists are still trying to unravel the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is just one of the most fascinating things, you know, in that it is sub below consciousness. Okay. And because it is below consciousness, some people may mistake it to be less intelligent than the conscious mind. And yet the subconscious mind is the most, I must say this, but it is so fascinating. I have noticed that if there's anything that can be tricked, when they say we want to trick your mind, what they're really tricking is your subconscious mind. I remember that somebody sent me something on social media where they had written, can you find the mistake? And then they wrote several numbers, I think from 1 to 9, all in different colors. And guess where I found myself checking? I kept on looking at the numbers to say, what is wrong with this? Where is the mistake? There is no mistake. Only for someone to show me that they wrote the twice. So what happened there was my mind tricked. I could read everything, and it's not a lot of things to read. But I realized that the subconscious mind automatically fixes things. So you might actually skip the mistake when it is right in your face. That, of course, happens when we're reading. I understand that we do not read every single letter. We probably work it out what the word is saying by looking at the first letter and the last letter. So interesting about the subconscious mind. However, the subconscious mind can be or can put you in great danger if you don't protect it. How does the subconscious mind work when you're watching television, for instance? When you're starting to watch, let's just say a kung fu movie, right? You can tell that that's Jackie Chan. You know that you've seen him in other movies, right? And you know that he's always doing karate or kung fu or something of the sort. But at the end of the movie, you'll notice that subconsciously you find yourself chopping the air, you know? And it's very interesting, is it not? Even when you're watching horror movies, again, you can probably tell that's Brad Pitt or that's whomever else, but you'll find it very hard to sleep at night. And yet you knew that these are the normal actors and actresses that we see everywhere. So when you start watching a movie, your conscious mind is what is in place. But when you now move more into the movie, there is something that they call in theater a willing suspension of disbelief. So at some point, you forget that you know these characters. At some point, you forget that you've watched them in other movies and that this is actually a movie. And you start to feel what is in the movie, the emotions that are in the movie. That's why people still cry in the movie. I find it so hard to imagine that there's some movies that I watch, maybe that I've watched them maybe 25 times, and I still cry. And it's not because I'm a woman. It's because of my subconscious mind, okay? Somehow, it just gets to a point where it gets to your emotions and it gets to you. And so, what are we trying to say about the mind today? Whatever you feed your mind is what it plays back to you. And sometimes whether or not you're going to succeed in overcoming temptation, it will actually depend on what you have fed your mind. So what feeds your mind? It is primarily your five senses. So what you touch is stored as information in the mind. What you eat influences your mind. What you smell, what you see, what you touch, what you hear, you will notice that all those five senses speak to or inform your readiness in any given situation. So let me give you just an example. If there is a person who constantly watches porn and they're always somehow on a high and they're training their mind to think in that way, when temptation comes, your mind works against you. And in fact, your body works against you as well. Now, let's look at just a few more fun facts about the mind. Through the mind, we feel our emotions. We feel happiness, we feel grief, we feel excitement, we feel embarrassment, right? It's all through the mind. And various hormones are also released to also influence our feelings, etc. And you also have some endorphins, you know, that are released, which can make you excited and make you happy or work as painkillers. And that all influences the mind. Now, after having said all that about the mind, and there's so much to say, right? Given a choice, human beings will choose to use emotions rather than their mind. They will choose to use whatever is exciting them, whatever is moving them, more than what is logical. And that takes me to the Bible. Come with me to the book of Proverbs, chapter 23, verse 7. And this speaks to the mind. The Bible speaks a lot about the mind, by the way. And what does it say? It says, ultimately, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Wow. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. What is that saying to you? Does it not say that you are the sum total of your thoughts? That whatever you concentrate your time on over time is what becomes you. Now, I find that very, very scary, friends, that if you were to get some kind of gauge that if you were to get some kind of meter to measure a person's thoughts from the beginning of the day to the end of the day, and you were to conclude the character of that person, I wonder what character yours would be. You see, our mind is our secret. Of course, God reads our mind, but to everyone else, nobody knows. And yet, the Bible says, whatsoever a man thinketh in his heart, that is the sum total of who he is. And what does that tell us? That tells us why God says he knows us, he knows our hearts. But many people have to get clues around us in order to discover who we are. So what are the thoughts that are emanating from your mind? What is it that you're holding in your mind? What is entertaining you? What do you spend your time on? Is it social media? Is it movie binging? Is it watching soccer? What is it that is occupying your mind constantly? The Lord says, and the Bible says, ultimately, that will speak to your character, to who you are. And so if you are a sum total of your thoughts, do you not suppose that you should start today to control your thoughts? And by extension, to control all those things that are feeding into your mind and influencing what your mind holds, which influences your character. I said, given a choice, human beings would rather not think. They would rather use emotion. I'll give you an example. When people, of course, when people are having dinner or supper, there are some topics that are forbidden from being discussed when people are having a meal. And what topics are those? They're actually universal, I think. It's religion. Whenever people are talking about and discussing religion, somehow all logic is thrown out of the window and people would rather use emotions. Politics. What happens when two political views clash? You always have fists. You even have wars. Why? Because push comes to shove. When given a choice, human beings would rather use their emotions than use logic. What else? Affairs or relationships. You take a young girl who's 17 who's in love. There is nothing you can do to convince that young lady to break up with a boyfriend that she loves. You can tell him, no, he does drugs. You can tell him, no, he's a good for nothing. He's a school dropout. He's not going to make anything in this life. And she will find every reason why she needs to continue to be with him. And so you'll notice that, as I said, given a choice, human beings would rather use their emotions than to think. Now, as I'm going there, I have just written down some things to give you as examples of what I mean when I talk about thinking and human beings refusing to think and rather using their emotions. Allow me to read this out. If people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't make certain choices that they make today. And I say to you today, if you allowed yourself just to use your brain at some point, you will notice that there are a lot of decisions you would actually not make or which you would have made differently. For instance, if some people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't be in the marriage or in the relationship they are in right now. And just while I'm there, I'll share something that I learned, which I found interesting. That in fact, your spouse is a reflection of your spiritual condition at the time that you got married. And so most of the time when a person marries someone, they are pretty much equally yoked, even though it would appear to everyone that they're not. And they're equally yoked. I say they're equally yoked because can two walk together unless they be agreed? You'll notice that unless there is a definite sign of coercion, it is actually true that your spouse is a reflection of your spiritual condition at the time you got married. Let's look at other examples. Now, if some people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't have followed or pursued the careers that they actually followed or that they're following now. One would notice that, no, that is not my strength. I don't have to, I don't have to succumb to peer pressure, etc. So a lot of students who are in school today, who are in college today, they are pursuing degrees they'd rather not have to pursued. And this is mainly, especially through peer pressure or parents or whatever is trending at the time, you'll notice that that is what influenced them and not logic. Right, let's move on. If some people allowed themselves to think, they would not have made certain investment choices that they made, whether it's in time or in effort or in money. If some people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't have started smoking or drinking or doing drugs. Just to think. So whenever you find young people who have found themselves having addictions they wish they could get rid of, look at where it started. somebody did not use their brains. They allowed everything else around them to influence their decision. If some people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't put certain chemicals in their bodies, which are disguised as food and drink. If some people allowed themselves to think, they would watch their mouth. They would not say half the things that they say. If some people allowed themselves to think, they would have waited until they got married before they started sexual relations. If they just allowed themselves to really think about it and not be caught up in the moment. Some other things, if people allowed themselves to think, they would unsubscribe for certain television programs that they subscribed to. In fact, a lot of people would altogether just switch off the television. This is when you allow yourself to think. If some people allowed themselves to think, they wouldn't eat half the things that they eat. They would carefully guard the things that get into their minds. They would throw a lot of items out of their wardrobes. If some people allowed themselves to think, they would study their Bibles more. They would spend more time in prayer. Why? Because the priorities, once you think, you start to get your priorities right. And you start spending more time where it is important and in a way that reflects where you want to go, where you're going, and that is heaven. A few more examples. If some people allow themselves to think, they would cut certain associations and friendships that they have. Now, understand something. You might go to the same church. It does not mean that you have to be friends. Please hear me carefully there. Remember, birds of a feather flock together. And people may be in church together. And, you know, you see this young person who's in your youth or, who's in your youth department, or this lady who's in the women's ministries department. It does not mean that you have to hang out with them. Remember, Christ picked his friends. He did not just flow with people because they found themselves in the same location. So sometimes we have to think about the people we are associating with, just even on a social level. Why? Because that influences who we are and who we become. And it reminds me of a joke where someone said, do you know that the people that you are making friends right now are going to be your children's references in the future? How about you consider that, to say, whoa, if my friends whom I'm hanging around with today will be the people that my child would depend on to make it in this world, will that child make it in this world? Of course, it's a joke, but it is very true. Indeed, we must be careful the people that we choose to spend time with, whose society we are investing in. If people allowed themselves to think, they would pay more attention to their children. They would pay more attention to their parents. They would pay more attention even to what they are feeding their bodies. They could even read more than to spend time in entertainment or other things which could be wasting your time over a period of time. Now, let's go quickly to what the Bible says. And before I start with the Bible, I've heard people say, I can't help what I think, because what I think is just what I think. No, you can help what you think. And in fact, you must help what you think. What does the Bible say? If we go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, it says, therefore, or wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Gird up your loins. Ha! Gird up your loins, the loins of your mind. Amazing. think about, I always imagine, I know gentlemen like to wear their trousers and then they always have a very good belt to keep everything together. Imagine a gentleman is giving a keynote speech at a huge conference, and in his rush to leave home, he realizes that he left his belt. You know, it becomes quite a disaster, doesn't it? And he could even go to another man and say, can I borrow your belt? How do I stand before these people without my loins being girded up properly? Now, if a man worries about things falling apart because he doesn't have a belt, how come we are not worried about things falling apart because we don't have a belt around our minds? And this is what the Bible is saying. Gird up the loins of your mind. Your mind needs a belt too. And so not only must you help what you think, you need to actually actively influence your thoughts. You cannot have your thoughts running away, going wherever they want to go. Because ultimately, even the judgment is going to be about your mind, what you put in your mind, and ultimately what your mind gave out. Why? The Bible also says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So you cannot speak things that you have not fed into your mind. I hope you are getting me very close, very, very carefully there. I hope you're getting me very clearly there. Let's see what else the Bible says. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. It says, you know what? You have to be careful. You can't just let it loose. You can't just let it go. You have to be very careful what is happening in your mind, because there is somebody who has an interest to destroy you. So you need to be sober. And how are you sober? By choosing not to be drunk. Be vigilant. How are you vigilant? By choosing not to slouch. By choosing not to be sloppy. You wake up and you say, I'm going to go on the go. Why? Because if you slack, or if you slacken, there is somebody who is ready to destroy you. Amazing about the mind. And there is that battle for the mind, where the devil wants to influence your mind, but the Lord wishes to influence your mind for good and for eternity. What else does the word of God say? Romans chapter 13, verse 11 says, and that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. Now is the time to awaken from sleep. Again, the thought of being sober and being vigilant is being repeated. Our salvation is closer now than it was when we started. And so it is your duty. Nobody else is going to do it for you. You are the one who needs to stay awake. And if you were slumbering, you need to wake up. Why? Because your mind, the minute you feed your mind with something, it seems to stay there. It seems to get stuck there. It reminds me of my little niece who, you know, I can't remember what book it was, but it had all sorts of scary pictures. And it belonged to an older cousin. And she started feeling afraid. She went to her dad, said, Daddy, I can't get these things out of my mind, you know. And Daddy says, where did you see them? And she says, in this book. And the dad's answer has never left me. He said soberly to her, darling, when you see something, you cannot unsee it. Wow. So when you hear something, you cannot unhear it. There is no way of extracting things out of your subconscious mind, out of your mind, and make it not having happened. Once you eat something, you cannot uneat it. And that's why people get sick every time they try to make themselves throw up. Every time you feel something or you smell something, you cannot unsmell it. And it becomes part of your memory. So whenever you go, in a garden full of, say, gardenias, you will remember something because you smelled those gardenias, which you smelled perhaps when you were a young person. So the word today is, once you do something and you feed your mind with something, you cannot unfeed it. And that is now what you depend on for feedback. That's what you depend on for strength. That's what you depend on as a guard and security against temptation, against problems, against decisions that you have to make without having reference to a book or anything like that. What else does the Word of God say? The Word of God has a lot to say about the mind. Now, did you know that God actually commands you to think? It is an imperative. If we read Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, God is instructing us on what to think. He says, whatsoever is good, whatsoever is right, whatsoever is noble, whatsoever is pure, if anything be excellent or praiseworthy, think on these things. It is an imperative. God is saying that you need to help what you think. So if you don't know what to think, it's important that you direct your mind on these things. If you're asking yourself, shall I watch this movie or shall I not watch this movie? Make reference to this verse to say, is it pure? Is it true? Is it of good report? Is it excellent? Then I'm allowed to think on those things. So God instructs that think on pure things. He knows the power of the mind. Let's go on. Matthew chapter 5 verse 17. I find this interesting and I just slipped it in because it talks about what not to think. It says, think not that I have come to destroy the laws and the prophets. I have not come to destroy them, but to fulfill them. So God directs not only the things to think on, but he also directs the things not to think on. Because there's some things that you must not allow your mind to dwell upon. And you need to be careful how you balance those two. So there's some things you can think of, but not spend too much time on them. There's some things that you should not even think of at all, because it might shift your view or shift your focus on where you want to go. Let's come to a conclusion. When you think you're taking on or putting on the character of God, Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, one of the most common verses, right? God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you. Thoughts for good, plans for good, and not to destroy you, to give you a hope and a future, or to give you an expected end. So if God, who created us, thinks, who are you not to think? Who are you to use your emotions over logic? And that doesn't mean that emotions are wrong or that we should not be in touch with our inner being. No. But when it comes to things that require logic, the message is very clear. Think. Use your brain. Use your brain. You see, God created us in his image. And when he created us in his image, I always find it interesting. So if you want to understand yourself, try to look at God's character. Try to look at what God did and what he has done. It will make it clear to you who you are and what you expected to do, because he created us in his image. And we get that from, of course, Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Now, if God thinks, are you acting or living his image if you are refusing to think? Let's try and break it down here. Just bring it down to the practical. Who is in your life that logically you should not have in your life? If you have such a person, go and break it off with them if it is a relationship. Who have you engaged in a business relationship with whom you know you shouldn't be in that business relationship? If you have such a situation, I would say go and cancel that agreement. Save yourself a lot of problems. Are you pursuing a law degree because your parents said you must pursue a law degree, but what is really in your heart is you want to be a veterinary scientist? There is always time to make a mid-course correction where you can make a U-turn, or you can take a turn to the right or to the left and pursue what you would like to pursue. Is there something that you're doing in your life that you know does not make sense? You know that for a fact. I implore you today to think. Use your mind. Using your mind does not mean that you've stopped being a Christian or you've stopped being religious. It just means that you have allowed yourself to be set free, to actually do and be what you were meant to be. Now, let me go to my very last verse, which I have found to be sometimes quite hilarious. And we get this from Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Can you turn to your Bibles and read with me? For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Let me try and put it into modern language. This verse is basically saying, do not think that you're all that. Don't think more highly of yourself than you should. This morning I was sharing with some young ladies the Desiderata, just a few nuggets from there. And what did it say? Never compare yourself with anyone, because there'll always be somebody better than you or worse off than you. And so when you think of yourself more highly than you are, that is almost the height of foolishness, because there's always somebody better than you. And in fact, you're putting yourself in a place where you're thinking you are not what you are, or you are thinking. In fact, you're putting yourself in a place where you are convincing yourself that you are what you're not, and that you're better than what you actually are. And a person who's in that mindset will find it very difficult to improve, because you're already up there and you feel that you do not need to do anything to improve yourself. The conclusion of what we are saying today: the mind is mind-boggling. And the strength that it has, and that was intended for it by God to benefit you, can be used by evil or by the devil to destroy you. And in fact, we don't even want to put the devil into it. You can train your own mind in such a way that it will destroy you. And that is why it's so important that we be in control of our environment, that we be in control of what we are feeding our minds. When you feed your mind healthy things, your mind will give you back healthy things. It's interesting how sometimes you might be having a conversation with someone and you are saying certain phrases and certain words in the cleanest sense, but all that they can tell is the dirty side of words. Why is that? Because someone has trained their minds to think in that way, or to think in a sexual way, or to have sexual connotations to every single thing that is said. And it can become very uncomfortable when you're having a conversation with such a person and they're finding fun in turning everything you're saying to something that you do not mean. And so, friends, as we are thinking about the sermon on the mind, my challenge to you today is, when you are given a choice to be emotional, when you're given a choice to be angry, when you're given a choice to be or to use anything else outside of logic in a situation where logic is required, I implore you to turn to logic. Use your mind. It is there for something. And always, of course, consult with the Almighty, because He communicates with us through the mind. May God bless the reading of His word.
Thank you, Maphosa, for that wonderful presentation on the mind today. I was just thinking about, you know, Jesus said, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. And when His mind is in our minds, we will think His thoughts. And He will give us the ability to choose the right thoughts to think, healthy thoughts, so that we can have a healthy, wholesome, and happy life. Let's bow our heads for prayer, and I'm happy to be closing out this evening for the Reclamation Project. I'm Pastor Trey, just in case, for those that may not know me. Please bow your heads and close your eyes. Lord, thank you for this wonderful presentation, and what a beautiful mind you have given all of us, really, and we can learn and grow to think more like you. And actually, so that our characters can become more like you. And help us not to be lazy with our minds and let anything just come in, but to guard the avenues of our soul. We want our minds to be purified so our minds can be prepared to receive the seal of God on our foreheads, which is actually your name written in our foreheads. So Lord, we thank you for what we've heard today, and I pray that we'll apply it to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, also, there's going to be a link if you want to come into our virtual lobby and just hang out and say hi, have a prayer, and just click on that link. We'll see you in just a few minutes. And next Sabbath will be real special. We have some of the team coming together in person in Maryland. It's going to be awesome. But you can find us right here next week. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
If I never get that house, that car, I'll be a superstar, and my dreams never come true. Will I be satisfied with you? And if no one ever knows my name and my gifts, don't bring me.
Everybody loves the love that all those nice things bring, but when the lights turn out and it's just me and you, when you
ask me to choose,
then
what will I do? See, if I gain the world, then I lose my soul.
Who's sick by my side when my years grow old? So
it's not easy, but when I think of you,
I want to be satisfied with you.
If I never get that house, that car, I'll be a superstar, and my dreams never come true. Will I be satisfied with you? And if no one
think money changes everything, but when all the money's gone, will I still be happy? How much did it cost me searching for celebrity? Did it
cost me my life.
Was it
worth the price?
I've been searching for so long for something real,
something deeper than what I see and feel.
It took me a while, now my search is through. Jesus, I'll be satisfied with you.
If I never get that house, that car, or be a superstar, and my dreams never come true, will I be satisfied with you? And if no one ever
satisfied with me
if I never